So give him a big hand and thank you very much for having us.
Thank you. And those who want to know the inside track, I bought my first computer from Vincent. So that's where the relationship started, Vincent, and we're here. It was called an M2, which was the second version of a computer that was called an M1, I think, was a Genesis brand. There you go. So we go back a long time. Yet I'm not worried at all after David Birch saying that the end of banking is near. So I'm not going to do a speech about that, frankly, because I would be on slippery territory. But I will want to welcome you. Welcome you to this conference and Rabobank and the discussion about innovation and blockchain. And I have brought with me at least some illustrations how a bank like Rabobank thinks about blockchain innovations, how we apply them, but also how we are part of the first blockchain commercial application in banking to go live. And so you can talk until the cows come home about all the innovations and about how banks are disrupted. If you look outside and ask yourself which one is live, you're talking to a banker that's live as of this month. So I guess there's at least something to say about banks, and let me just try it for 10 minutes and then you go on with blockchain innovation. The other thought I had about David's introduction is, after he went through the logical owners or the logical issuers or the logical parties that would unite or would bring out these ICOs, he ended with communities. And Rabobank is, yes, it is a bank, but it started as a cooperative. And a cooperative is a community of investors that invest in entrepreneurs. And that by combining those entities and the trust that the middleman creates, the cooperative is a community. And so we see at the heart of the blockchain innovations and many of the fintech innovations that are taking place a recurrence of the very fundament of a cooperative, which is you connect investors, you build an entity that creates a standard and a basis for trust, and you gear it to those entrepreneurs that are best benefited by it. So if that, let's say, old thought can be linked up with all the new thoughts that David brought, I think we're onto something new and we're innovating at scale on the blockchain. And before I go a little bit into what we are actually doing as a start, let me just reflect a little bit on this moment in time. Because if you look outside and you listen to David and you read the headlines, you can either be interpreting one of two changes. One is there is still a lot of hype in this blockchain technology space, and a lot of the investments will go nowhere, and a lot of the players will crash, and a lot of, in other words, it is still in the infant stage, and there's nothing live in the financial sector yet. On the other time, on the other side, you're asking many of the leaders in the industry, and they're saying the whole world will be different. And that's the moment we're in. And the very fundament of what is happening at that moment is the experiments that are taking place right now, where we do proof of concept. And I think the whole proof of concept phase is what we're in right now, and that's where we're mostly invested at this moment. I think it will fundamentally alter the way finance is done. I think it will fundamentally alter the way many of the contracts are done. I think it's still a long way away because it's just very complicated to build an infrastructure, an open standard whereby everybody treats it with the same standard. So it is a long way. We're at this tilting point, and I'd just like to take you along with what we're doing. So we apply innovation at scale within Rabobank in a way that not only does it as a portfolio of initiatives, it also invites all of the people from Rabobank to participate. And the innovation that Vincent mentioned, the IBAN checker, the name checker, was an innovation of two individuals that participated in an innovation bootcamp. And they came up with the idea, they said we can do this, there were 25 people said you can't, they proved it, and it was then applied as a simple improvement to our app, and it's now live, and it's now also taken over by all the other banks. A simple application invented by two individuals, and then scaled up and done. That is a funnel, and the funnel consists of three phases: an ideation phase, where we freely investigate without constraints new ideas, new concepts, new applications, and I'll give you some examples. Then you go into the validation phase, where you're putting together not only the technology but also the partners in the chain, and you're really shaking the idea and saying, is there a fighting chance technology-wise? Is there a chance that consumers, customers want it? Is it possible to build scale and to get it going? And then you go, if you test that phase, you go into implementation. And I'll show you some examples of each of these. And then in particular go into detail on the last one, which will be live as we speak, or this month. Ideation is really about stepping outside of the constraints, and we've been criticized or questioned or tested on, for example, the Rabobit side of this page, where we said we want to investigate whether consumers feel a benefit if a bank plays a role in their cryptocurrency activities. And this is not to say that we're going to do it, but we want to investigate it. We want to understand whether there is a need, how you can do that. And the philosophy of this is really the very example that was given about the Wild West. Is in cryptocurrencies today, there's a lot of uncertainty about the validity of its users. If we can, as a bank, play a role in creating a space into that cryptocurrency world that can be trusted, where you know the counterpart, even though it goes via the lower layer that David Birch used, a number, if you can create that space, you've adopted security and trust into that currency domain, and that is what we're trying to understand. Is there a need? Is there a possibility? Is there a wish? Rabobit. It's only ideation. We're doing investigation. We're talking to the regulators intensively to get them with us. But if it flies, then we have a start of an idea. If it doesn't, we don't. We are doing an access point to the blockchain world with an exchange where you can do the contractual benefits of the blockchain and combine it with real money. That's an access point. We're looking at the mortgage process, which is very complicated, so it's attractive. We're doing an agri-wallet whereby a farmer in the core of our strategy does the payment on a cryptocurrency blockchain backbone, and you use that to also do a savings technology whereby you can invest in next year's Harvard conversion in time. And then we have developed this distributed application or decentralized application, the networking app that was just presented. For your information, that requires a few lines of code. And we thought it would be a nice experiment to see how can you use this open programming language and then use just a few lines of code and see whether it flies. And so the app that you'll be downloading actually only has a few lines of code that we put on top of a public standard. Interesting idea to see whether it flies. Ideation. Here you're not looking at constraints yet, you're just seeing whether it works. When you go to validation, you try to put it technically together, and there we're you're seeing a lot of examples whereby you're coming to the core of the strategy of this bank. Rabobank is not only a consumer bank in the Netherlands, a bank for entrepreneurs and SMEs in the Netherlands, it's also a bank in the global food supply chain. And so in validation, you typically see a lot of ideas that are at the core of consumer and customer needs. And here are a few. There's in the coffee quality idea, we're tracing the quality of coffee. And by logging that at the farmer's gate and logging that onto a blockchain information sharing contract, the coffee gets higher value, the producer gets higher price, there's trust in the system, and it flies. We're experimenting that with a whole chain of players. When you look at the T area, the Providence app that we're trying to develop in Malawi, here it is about the routing for where does the T come from. And so in that partnership, there is the Unilevers, there is a bank's infrastructure, there is local suppliers. It's all the players in the chain that try to figure out, can we form a contract form whereby we can trace the quality of food and thereby make better practices in the farm gate happen by the traceability. Because if the consumers in the Netherlands, England, Europe, US know that the tea is good and the practices that the farmer has applied are sustainable, you can start to influence the sustainability of food supply. And blockchain is very helpful in that. So we're really testing these things and then see whether we can scale it up and whether it makes logic sense. There's a pay-per-use application and you can share the use of big equipment. And in the real estate area, we're trying to see whether we can find a common language for the rental details in contracts, and they're frequently shared. Can you come up with one language and everybody enters it and it's shared? In other words, pretty advanced experiments where there are players in the chain involved, technology is applied, but it's not yet over the hill of knowing this will fly. And then you move into the next phase, and that's where we have a big thing live. As of this month, we will launch WeTrade, where it has commercial application. And this is just beyond the production stage. WeTrade is aimed to facilitate cross-border trade by mostly SME entrepreneurs, middle-sized entrepreneurs that go outside of their country, export, and are facing the uncertainty of knowing the counterpart and of knowing whether the money will be paid and whether or not they will fulfill this other side of the contract. And by creating a common standard of language in that trade, by connecting banks, in this case, 9 banks in 11 countries, and getting their customer base connected onto that trade platform, you can provide instant certainty to the parties that want to export, and you can provide instant certainty and access to financing if that's needed. So here, blockchain is an ideal language framework and a repository of contractual steps that you can use, and we did connect the players. We did develop the technology together with IBM, who has been, again, here at the forefront. IBM has been great as a partner stepping into this space and putting up some real money to develop the technology. But now this thing is about to go live, and this month the thing will be there, and we'll see later on how it works. But people will give some presentations in this conference. And here you have, as far as we know, the first blockchain application that's commercially going to go live in the financial industry in the world. How does it do? What does it do? I think I won't go into the details also because there's a big red light blinking in my face. It essentially does what I just described. It has a contract form where you register from the start, and people can track all the goods floating through the chain, and they can check all the contractual steps that happens when you ship goods. The side benefit is that if an enterprise is working with this standard and he has filled in all the contractual aspects, you can provide him instant payment for the movement of goods, and a whole new growth starts to emerge. So we think this actually creates new possibilities for trade and new growth that otherwise wouldn't. Here's how it looks when you enter it, and there will be a demonstration later on, and you can see it outside also in the booth. So what did we learn? What did we learn from all of this experimentation? What is the lesson that a giant bank learns from experimenting and innovation in the blockchain space? We need this technology because it provides so many benefits, whether it's efficiency, it's ease of use, but also growth for our customers. But the decentral side of it is pretty challenging. We like to think that you create innovation and the world follows, but here you have to do it together. It also requires collaboration with parties that you co-design with, and that whole collaboration phase actually takes a lot longer. When I was here last time, Vincent, at your conference, I announced this would happen. The timing by which it went live was a couple months, I think 6 later than we promised. It does take time. And so this promise of a burst of blockchain technology in the world taking place in the next 5 years, I think everybody will discover the same laborious process that it takes to develop those standards. It will just take time. Also, you need to step out of your comfort zone as a bank and to meet all sorts of parties in an open space whereby you can't do everything yourself, and you use external code that's live, and you bring it in, and you go into all sorts of new meetings that is just new. We have now about a hardcore of about 15, 20 people in the blockchain space, but in total in Rabobank there are now 200 people working on blockchain-specific projects, meeting up with even more people outside of the bank, putting that together. It's a new universe. We are experimenting at scale, and we don't believe one technology will survive, so we're using all sorts of alternatives. And maybe the last, this also requires for a bank like Rabobank, who is a cooperative grounded in a community thought, who is aimed at preserving certainty and build trust in society and with our customers, to be courageous to do sometimes things that are far outside of that comfort zone. And that's what we learn. Of course, for you it's all natural, but we have to learn this, and only when you do that do you discover these new applications that we have presented here. I hope you have a great conference. I thank you for your attention, and thank you for being in this room with us today.
Okay, let's get some questions up, Wiebe. It was really, you have now 9 banks connected. German, Deutsche Bank. Yep. Deutsche Bank, and what was the Spanish one?
The Spanish bank, there's a French bank, and there's a
big, huge banks. Some of them are much bigger than Rabobank. And you work together in a little bit more than a year to have a joint data account, because now you have a joint client account you basically can find, and you can say, I want to send money to him under these conditions. And then basically, if these conditions are met, then you pay automatically. You still pay in the old Swift way, right? It's basically the old the payment thing is still up. But everything else, the interaction is really done.
It is.
And you've set it up so that thousands of other banks can join.
That's right. It's open.
And so what do you complete? That is that took, I mean, about 1.5 years. Is that not extremely fast in this kind of world?
It is extremely fast when you think about the standard that it requires of working on one platform and everybody on the same page. But it's still 1.5 years after its inception, so it takes a long time.
I think that after the technology is perfect, it takes 7 years before it basically gets traction. Well, of course, the crypto was a little faster, but I mean, and you're not afraid. I mean, if at Money 2020, everybody, you were there, the keynote speaker last year at that nice, big, huge stage.
Copenhagen,
you know?
Yeah.
This is a teeny, teeny little stage compared to Money 2020. It was like the whole room was the stage. But you're not afraid if you see all these predictions that the role of the bank, that instead of 19,000 retail banks, that we own, that if Facebook does a good job and they basically do a current account and a savings account and maybe a mortgage and maybe a little bit.
I'm not afraid.
Why
and
not?
The reason I'm not afraid is that there's a lot of transaction speak when we talk about those predictions, and it's about can I do a trade or a transaction? And there, I think there will be huge inroads from players like
Google, Facebook,
everybody. But that's all transaction side of banking.
Yeah. Which basically you make a loss of. You don't make any money out of that.
Well, it's quite hard to make money on transactions. Yes. And so you can also see we have this ideal transaction platform in the Netherlands. It's for free. Yes. And that's the reason why it's very hard for these players to come in and to make any money on transactions, because we have this platform shared. What the bank also does is it converts time. So, and this need of, I'm an entrepreneur, I want to invest now and I only make money later, mm-hmm. I need an institution to be with me at the beginning of that investment and to then pay back to later on, is an aspect that these players don't want
to be. That's why you make your money. You know,
that is where a bank makes money.
In lending money, that is basically going to be the whole account, the current account thing.
Agreed.
And a little bit of saving, that's not really interesting. Yeah. It's really about loaning money.
It is, and the second thing is the notion of built up trust. And so when a regulator looks at a bank, rightfully so, it says, I'm not interested whether the machine works. They're interested whether the machines work, and they test that, of course.
Yeah.
But they're mostly worried about, will this institution survive a cycle of ups and downs? And so I think you need to also look at the whole technology space, and will it survive a boom and bust cycle?
Yeah.
Will it survive a real technological shakeup? Will the trust pervade? I think this is also something that is still an asset for banks. And so I think it's a rat race, and one of the venture capitalist in California said it in the following way. He said, I think it's a competition between the established players that have the trust. They need to race up to build up innovation. And the innovators that don't have the trust yet, that race to build up the trust.
Yeah.
And that rat race is on, and we have a huge card to play. So I'm not too worried about the future, but we need to race.
There was one question. He said, supply chain and blockchain cannot mix for as long as there's humans in the chain. What do you think of that? You can see it there. It's over there in front of you. What do you think? I mean, can we have humans in the chain somewhere who has to decide that the money has to be transferred, or does everything has to be computerized?
I think somebody thought hard about this statement, but there is some truth in it, but there's also some non-truth in it. And so there are many people in supply chain these days that are intermediate stages.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of paperwork in the supply chain that's just very laborious and are labor intensive. If you can connect the trust of the people in the front and the back of the chain with the intermediate platform being
and
a blockchain.
Take 80% out, then maybe 20%
leave. You
take out
a lot of the people in between. So I think there's still people needed at the back end and the front end of the chain, but the intermediate stage can largely go on a standard contract.
If you move a container from China to Rotterdam, there's 200 documents involved.
It's
and
horrendous.
The cost of processing those 200 documents, you know, it only costs $1,000 to move a container from China to here.
It's even worse.
It's
even worse.
Today,
now it's not only that there are huge numbers of documents, sometimes these documents have to be cycled from an office to the harbor to get a stamp. So
it takes longer to get the documents over than the container or something.
Yeah,
so it's really
very horrible.
So he's not worried about it. So good luck with WeTrade. I hope you were going to go live today, but it's going to be tomorrow or Monday or when?
This month.
Yeah, but
it's ready.
We can see it working. We can see it working at the tech tracker. It will be explained at some tracker, so it will be at the business track with Connie. We will see how
there
it
go.
Works.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, people.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Bye.
Okay.